So good afternoon, everybody. So I think I got enough PR for my talk from Tyler and Paul. So I hope we'll get more people. So yeah, so I don't know whether you can remember this situation. So my kids asked from me what I'm going to do for this conference. Because they help me while I'm when I do the slides, so I told them I'm going to present two papers that I wrote during last 2 months. So then they asked whether it's going to be a situation like this. So this is a frame from the movie called The Words. The person who wrote a book is reading the book. Then I said it's not going to be boring that much, but yes, I'm planning to read two papers. But not reading, just try to walk you through these two papers that we released yesterday, the reference architecture for agility and the reference methodology for agility. So as a recap, yesterday both Tyler, Paul, and then John, as well as during the panel discussion, we discuss about the integration agility and then how we can move the technology, people, process into a direction and then meet these goals. So what I'm trying to do is dig in deep and then go through both reference architecture as well as reference methodology. So let's start with the reference architecture. For me, my definition of a reference architecture is a guideline that you can refer and then build something usable. The beauty of the reference architectures are it's a reusable thing, and then when it's iterate and it get better and better. So that's what a reference architecture looks like. So I picked the Wikipedia definition as well, but what it says basically, it's a template solution that provides for different domains. Since we are coming from the integration middleware domain, so the reference architecture that we build should be able to apply for any business domain. So that is one approach that we took during this exercise. So, to set some background, this is a layered architecture that we published, I think, 4 years back by considering what are the middleware needs and then by looking at what are the service-oriented architecture principles. So it's a layered architecture. In a layered architecture like this, what will happen? The data will flow from layer to layer. And then, as Tyler Paul explained yesterday, each and every middleware layer will be owned by a team and managed by a specific team. So that's what we architected for a long time. I think it started from single-tier architecture to two-tier architecture, three-tier, then we got variations of three-tier like MVC, and then it came to N-tier, but all these architecture patterns were following the layered architecture. That something looks like this. Then from that, we moved to the microservices architecture, I think 4 years back. The original microservices architecture patterns came, it's kind of a spaghetti thing, but when you apply it inside the enterprise, again, it became layered because you need to deal with the existing data, existing systems, and then partner systems, so and so forth. So what happened, the microservices became another layer on a layered architecture and then surrounded with other layers that you're already running. So that is the reference architecture we had before yesterday, even in our slide decks as well. So so we were using this the layered architecture, and luckily one of my CFPs that I submitted for at O'Reilly Software Architecture Conference in London, it got accepted. I think if you are submitting CFPs, you know how hard to get a CFP accepted in a software conference like that. So it's a completely architecture focused conference. Then I thought, okay, now okay, my paper was about iterative architecture. Then I figured the layered architecture currently we have, it doesn't clearly address and it doesn't support iterative architecture. So need to come up with something else. Then I looked at what most of of our customers doing. Then identified within the layered architecture, there's a sub pattern that within the layers, based on the ownership as well as functional capabilities, you can segment or create subgroups within each and every layer, and those layers, segmentation owned by different groups. So then we name this as a segmented architecture. So it's in between the architecture that I'm going to explain you and the layered architecture, but we identify even this doesn't address the problem that we are trying to solve. So what's the problem? So basically the problem is there's a mismatch. So we are building different kind of architecture and reference architecture patterns. There's a mismatch with the technology, especially the microservices, containers, so and so forth, the latest technologies that we have. Again, it doesn't support to be fully agile. So there's a gap between that as well. Another thing, while I'm doing the research about other reference architectures that I found, most of the reference architectures are not reference architectures. Those are reference implementations that you will be doing by using X technology. So for me, it's not a reference architecture. So what we thought when we are building the reference architecture, we should not stick to any technology. It has to be technology neutral. So the cell-based architecture is the one that we came up with. I think you heard a lot about it in a very high level during yesterday. So I'll give the history on how and why we came up with this cell-based architecture. So this is fall, I think everybody so fall. So one picture took in 2011 with my family, and then this is after he got graduated. So what happened, Paul took study leave in 2014. And then to complete his PhD, and in 2018 he came back as a CTO in January. So after Paul returned, what we did, we formed this new organization structure called the CTO office. So this is the reference architecture for the CTO's office. Most of the stuff in the in your left-hand side, I own it, and then the stuff on your right-hand side owned by this gentleman called Srinath Pereira. This is the structure that we have. As part of the plan, we identify we need to define a new reference architecture and methodology. So that's the start that we did in, actually February 1st, we started this activity. So the building the concept, Paul gave you a lot of insight, but what we did, we looked at this microbiology stuff, and then system biology, then quantum computing, and then a lot of good stuff inside Kubernetes, container orchestration system. So these are kind of the raw materials that we use, addition to the research work that we did about the existing architectures that we can find. So the cell-based architecture, the atomic unit of the cell-based architecture, we call it as a component. So component can be anything. It can be a microservice, it can be a function, it can be existing legacy service, it can be a database, it can be a gateway. So whatever you can find and treat as a runtime, we treat it as a component. And then if you download the paper and go through it, we have categorized the components into different categories as well. So in the architecture, this is the atomic unit that we identify. So the cell is a combination of components. So it can be one-to-one, or it can be one-to-many. In most cases, it will be one-to-many, but in some cases, you might just write a microservice and then make a cell out of it. So both patterns we can find. And the beauty of this architecture, you have a boundary now, because the problem with the microservices are too granular to treat it as an architecture unit. So the cell provide that boundary, so you can categorize your services, microservices, systems, and databases by using the concept. Then the communication. That's a formatting issue. So the communication between the cells, how it works basically, that's a cell gateway. So always the communication happens through the cell gateway. and it can be an ingress or egress communication. Addition to that, if you need to go outside the cell, like as example, a service need to call some kind of a SaaS application or a database, you can use the patterns that the container patterns they introduce, like a sidecar, adapter or ambassador, and do the communication outside from the cell. So that's how the cell communication happen between each and every cell. So if you look at it as a enterprise architecture, this is what I think it will looks like. There will be a lot of cells. So I categorize the cells into end user application cells that people will write end user applications. It can be a web app, mobile app, or some kind of IoT application running on a smart device. And then I name the next layer, next set of cells called the cloud native cells. Those are the things that we can treat it as a microservice or a function that the modern application development stuff. And then you will find enough legacy cells like the Courts applications, and then databases, the services that you created using service-oriented architecture, so and so forth. So those things we treat as a legacy cell. Then you will find a number of external cells as well. It can be a system that one of your partners exposed, or it can be a SaaS application that you are, have subscribed. So those things you can treat it as a external thing, external cell. So the internal and external differentiation comes based on the ownership. So we initially thought we should treat who owns the data, and then based on that, keep the boundary. But the problem with that approach, now if you take a SaaS application, you own the data, but you only own a tenant and the cell owned by a third party. So we thought of just treat the ownership who's managing and running this particular cell will have, based on that, you decide whether it's an internal cell for the organization or an external cell for the organization. So this is a reference implementation, a hypothetical scenario that I took with couple of cells, like an employee cell, order cell, a customer cell, and then they connect to different type of legacy cells as well. There's a database and a user store, then order management system. Then some of the cells are exposing the capabilities to the application layer. And if you carefully notice, there are APIs, and there are streams, and then there are events as well. So that is how an implementation will look like when you architect and build a system using the cell-based architecture. So then there are two levels of communication, the intercell communication and the intracell communication. So the intracell communication, to do that, there's a control plane inside the cell, and then there's a data plane inside the cell. But to communicate in between the cells, there's a control plane outside the cell as well as a data plane outside the cell as well. So this concept clearly maps with the concepts like service mesh that you can utilize. And we will provide more and more support from the tools that we will provide, how to create a cell and how to deploy it in future as well. So that is something that we have already started looking at and will help you. But if you look at the technologies like Kubernetes, you can easily map this stuff now. In a very high level, you can map a cell into a Kubernetes namespace and then deploy it in your infrastructures as well. Then the security and governance is really important. So the way we treat the cell, now cell got a gateway, and gateway pattern is a really nice pattern, because entire communication will happen through that. So that way you can enforce different kind of policies at the gateway. So gateway act as a policy enforcement point in this architecture. So it can go and pick the policies from a registry, and then if you need to monitor and monitor what's really happening, you can push the communication information into observability layer through the gateway. So that's how the governance will happen, and the control plane will provide all the policy information, so and so forth. So that is how the governance managed at the cell level. Then the security, like these are two possible patterns. So I think you listen to Prabhat in the morning. So Prabhat and myself, we are planning to write another paper only focus on the cell-based architecture, how security handled in the cell-based architecture. So that will be available in the future. But very high level, what I want to highlight here, you can have different kind of patterns here. The first pattern, the security token service will be inside the cell in the control plane and then provide all the relevant information for the gateway to do the authorization and authentication. And the second pattern, the control plane inside the cell will connect to the external control plane that will have IDP with additional security credentials and information. So it will provide those things to the control plane inside the cell. So you can based on your security architecture, how you need to treat your security token services, and then how you store your users in different kind of user stores, you can decide which pattern that you can use. But the architecture is flexible to handle any kind of security pattern that you want to implement, and we will provide more and more guidance through the paper that we are planning to write and publish. So then the life cycle and versioning is key as well. So we did look at it. So if you look at in this example, now the cell one got a single version, and it's having four stages of the life cycle: dev, test, staging, and production. And the cell 2, it has two versions, like 3.0 version that we assume still on development. Still actively improving. So you got the dev and test as well as production. But the 2.7.0 version is mostly development is done basically. So it doesn't have the dev test environment. It got the staging and production. But if you look at it based on your infrastructure, like if you are in a completely cloud native or even a virtualized environment that you can quickly spin up, you don't need to run all these environment if you are not actively working on those. Whenever you need it, you can spin up. So that is how we thought that the lifecycle management and versioning of the cells will work in a cellular architecture. So the hypothetical scenario I mapped to a reference implementation, a level one reference implementation, to look how it will looks like. So I pick a bunch of technologies provided by WSO2, and then some other possible technologies that industry is using. So if you look at some of the services and gateways represented by Ballerina, that's the a logo that you will learn more tomorrow if you attend the BallerinaCon. And then some of the services written using Spring Boot, and then there are different kind of data storages, caching storages, and then there are external cells, like I took Salesforce as one example, because it provides an API, you can treat it as a gateway there. And then legacy applications like SAP, and some of the gateways, if you notice, it's not only the API gateway, that even a ESB can treat as a gateway and then expose these capabilities. So, and then the identity component, I put it in a different cell, that the identity server connect to LDAP and work in that way. And there's another external cell that connect to Workday. And if you look at the application, the end user application layer, different technologies, and those treated as cells as well, that Node and then React, Angular, so and so forth. So it's a kind of a hypothetical scenario with the possible technologies. So what I want to highlight it, it's the reference architecture is technology neutral, that based on your environment and then based on how each and every development team using these technologies, you can map them and then use the architecture and implement the system the way that you want. But we prefer to you to utilize more and more WSO2 products, but it is compatible with other technologies as well. So in summary of the cell-based reference architecture, the component is the atomic unit, and then a set of components will build the cell, and a cell is self-contained, and you can deploy it as a unit, as well as you can scale it. So that's the beauty of this architecture, based on the scaling needs. You can individually scale the cell, as well as within the cell you can individually scale the components as well. So that is how it will address the elasticity. And then as I explained earlier, there's an internal data plane and there's an internal control plane. That cell can be self-contain and run, and it will connect to the external data plane and control plane and connect with the other cells. So that's how it is. So if you read the paper, I think you will get more and more context, because we have detailed explained this. And the paper that we released yesterday is 0.9, because I need to do some improvements to that as well. And then our plan is to get more and more reference implementations, like based on different domains, different technologies, even how you can optimize WSO2 technologies and build a cell architecture. Those things we are planning to release in future as part of this effort. Then the next section of this talk about the reference methodology. Again, Tyler, Paul, they kind of explain in very high level what is our strategy and what's our roadmap and how we are planning to help. So I'll try to deep dive into this section as well. So basically, it's about people, processes, and technology. You combine these three and then build something meaningful. That's about the definition of the methodology. And again, I put the Wikipedia definition as well. It's basically like how you theoretically analyze this stuff and then put it together for somebody to use, utilize, and then build something meaningful. So if you look at the timeline, like we used to use different kind of methodologies, from waterfall into scale agile frameworks that you find today. Even we have number of different methodologies that we use. I put them into two buckets, like waterfall and then agile, and there are kind of merge in between as well. So that is what we find today. So why we need a new reference architecture? So the first thing is, even you are agile, this is my 8-year-old daughter. So even if you are agile, if your environment is not supporting, you can't be agile. So that is the first problem. And then again, with the layers that we identify, layers create gates, so that blocks the process as well. So those are the two, three main things that we that encourage us to identify a new methodology and help organizations to be truly agile and overcome these situations. So if you look at the methodologies, most of the methodologies address people, process, and technology, but we enhance it a little bit. So the culture and the architecture, we thought it's the foundation for the people, process, and technology. And then as outcome, you get the digital alignment. So that's the result that you get from an improved process. Then the, with that exercise, we identified the maturity model. Basically, we made it for like four dimension, like the people, process, technology, and then the new thing that we added is the digital alignment. And then the five stages that an organization can stage. So basically, monolith, fast waterfall, API-driven, early agility, and integration agility. So we read a lot of theory behind this, but this came from our experience working with many customers. So we name these things according to what we felt about where those teams are standing today. And then we map the reference architecture to this maturity model as well, the layered architecture, segmented architecture, and the cell-based architecture, how it will help to move to the right. But if you look at an organization, like, you will not vertically align, because this is what we will see if you look at in the field. An organization can be on like very left side on one category, but they might be improved in the other category. So the when we define the when we do the maturity model assessment and then identify a roadmap to move forward, we need to identify where exactly the organization stands now and then have a path to move each and every layer. But then again, it's not practical that you will move in a you can kind of align everything and then move. So we need to come up with a plan and then make sure that we move all the four layers into the right hand side by having a proper plan. And then the transformation also, we identify it has to be an iterative process, that you plan and then you implement, review and then improve. So it has to go through that. Even during the panel discussion yesterday, we discussed this thing, how you can have a iterative process, because you have to do the change, but it should not affect the business. The business has to run in the normal way while you are making these changes. So an iterative approach to this business transformation is very important when you are doing that. Then the how you are moving to the right. So the three stages that I highlighted here: fast waterfall, API driven, and early agility. So if somebody is in the monolithic stage, then what they can do, basically start doing the integration. It's basically use technologies like ESB, AI, message brokers, so on and so forth, and start integrating internal systems as well as external systems. So that is the first stage that you will be doing, and then assign those responsibilities to different teams. When you are improving, what you can do, that the next stage we call the API driven. So basically wrap all these complexity with the APIs and then provide APIs as a way to access your business capabilities and functionality. So that's the next stage. So it's API driven. With that, there will be a cultural change, that you will find different API teams that develop the APIs and provide it as a service for the organization. Then the early agility level, the application development teams and some of the even backend development teams, they will operate individually as agile teams, but they have to go to the central platform that we call as the center of excellence, and then deploy these things. So that's why it's not true agile, that the part of the organization will operate in agile mode, but rest of the organization will still will be in waterfall fashion. So then the integration agile is where that we call kind of nirvana, so where you want to be. So it's basically the organization structure is a podular structure, that you work as small teams, and then each and every team will own, like they will plan, they will build, they test, they run, they manage. And they are very close to the end user as well, so they can feel how they are using the products and then get the feedback and improve it. And DevOps is doing a huge part of this, like if you look at the diagram, the continuous integration, testing, all these processes are there to make them streamlined. You need to have a very good DevOps process. And then the environment-wise, like how you quickly release something, you will introduce like blue-green kind of deployments, and then canary kind of deployments as well, to test quickly and then put something into production that will not break the production systems, as well as that will not affect the consumer experience as well. So this is a very high level overview of what we think the integration agile environment looks like, and then the transformation we are helping with the reference architecture and the reference methodology. So let's look at what are the best practices that we can do to achieve this goal. So I'll start with the people. So what we are proposing, first thing is create a team called Agile Core, because you have to start from somewhere. So when you are picking the Agile Core, identify the capabilities that you require to deliver the project, as well as a set of people who can easily change and then accept the changes. So basically using the Agile Core, you can use this technique called the train the trainer, and then internally start building the new Agile teams. So that's the first step. And then we call them as self-organized teams. Basically, they plan, they do the design, they do the development, and even the DevOps is inside that particular team. So they release and they continue that process. So that's where the self-organized teams are coming. Even like the business users might be inside that particular team as well, rather than the requirements coming from outside. And then the next thing is now in Scrum and then Extreme Programming, you have an Agile Master like who run the stand-up meeting and all this stuff. Even it's funny, even Scrum, you run the stand-up meeting in the morning, right? Every day you run it in the morning, and most of the people might miss the stand-up meeting. Even that is not agile, because stand-up meeting should run at any time that most of the people can occupy. So in this model, what we are telling everyone is an agile master. The role will change. Probably at the start, the beginning of the project, the architect might run a bigger role. Then a senior developer might take control, and at some point a DevOps person might take control, a test engineer take the controller. So basically treat everyone equally, and then we call like, okay, everybody run the role of Agile Master at some point of the project life cycle. Then the process-wise, what we are proposing, you have to be iterative. So we repeatedly explain this thing. So everything has to be iterative, like you do something, get the feedback, improve, and then continue. The second thing is the continuous nature comes with agility and the DevOps. So you need to treat DevOps really highly and then use all the DevOps automation and the best practices into your development process. So with this, you can't completely alienate the DevOps, like the developers also should have some kind of knowledge about DevOps as well. Then the code over config is another thing that we discussed yesterday as well. So having a more code-based approach will help you to streamline your DevOps pipelines as well as continuous integration, continuous testing, so on and so forth. And then the integration first, we identify that there are a lot of programmable endpoints we have. So how you can have how you can develop an application by integrating these smart endpoints. So you need to give the upper hand for the integration, and when you are architecting the system, you have to create an integration architecture using different kind of data flows and integration points, so and so forth. So you need to give more prominence for that as well. Then the technology-wise, the pipeline tune means like you have to have an automated way of getting a developer set up their environment, like how you quickly create your sandbox environment, how it connect with your source control system, how it get connected to the build pipeline. Because I think if you are a developer, you know how frustrating that is, like you take a lot of time to create the environment and set it up. Even I can remember I had spent the entire weekend to set up the environment without doing any coding. So that's the usual experience we have. So what we are highlighting here, you have to have a proper automated process to make the developer productive. And then the multi-environment based application, that's where these blue-green deployments, canary deployments, so and so forth comes. At least you should have two environments, otherwise it's really hard to do rapid application development. Then the test-driven development, you have to give priority for testing, and there's a You have to create the test data sets and then the test scenarios first and start development. Otherwise, again, you can't do the continuous delivery. Then the cloud native features, as much as you can utilize the containers, container orchestration systems, so and so forth. And obviously, use the cell-based architecture as architecture pattern. And use open source, because the beauty of open source, you don't need to wait, that you can quickly experiment and then put the stuff into production as well. Then the digital alignment, what we are telling, it has to be consumer driven, that you have to take the requirements from the consumer rather than you create hypothetical scenarios and then build applications. And always start with the MVP, identify what's the most viable product and then release it as soon as possible. And the applications should be digital native. What I call digital native as those should be personalized. Provide a personalized experience, and then should provide a real-time experience, and should provide a geo-sensitive experience based on where they are, and then it has to be a predictable experience as well. And then the last point is, since we talk about an iterative process, you should have enough feedback loops to capture how people using the applications, what's the performance of the application, what is the stability of the application, what are the runtime behavior of the application. All these things need to be configured and then have a proper observability layer as well. So if you are interested on like get these things implemented, we will come up with a proper model. But for now, if you are interested, you can contact me. These are my email, and even you can go and fill the contact us form, or you can connect with me in LinkedIn. These are the two links to download these two papers as well. If you are interested, you can get it from there. So I will finish my talk with this quote, because now even we identify this five-stage model, the transformation is the journey. So when we identify the improvements that you can make, we will release a new version of the paper as well. And it's okay to be in any stage. That's where we can come and help you to move to the right as much as possible. I hope you enjoy the talk, and I encourage you to download the papers and give us feedback and get in touch with us. Can you take a question, or do you want? One question. Yeah, so it's hard to define it at the reference architecture level, Gautam, because when it comes to a domain-specific reference implementation, we might be able to give you some guidance. So as I said, it might be 101 in some cases. You might have one microservice with a gateway, or it can be 10, 11, 12 services. So it's for now, it's hard to give that till we get couple of reference implementations, but keep it so basically in some cases one cell will own by one team, so based on their responsibilities and the capabilities that they are trying to provide, we need to decide number of microservices or services that will inside that. Yeah. 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 Exactly. So that's the one.
Repeat the question for everybody.
Yeah. So the question is basically the guidance on like how you limit the number of components, the best practice of how many components that should be inside a cell. Since this is more kind of a pragmatic approach, that we don't need to just tell, okay, this number of cells, but definitely we will guide you while we are building reference implementations using the cell-based architecture.